I'm on. There's a sweet, sweet spirit here tonight. Satan has tried his best to change my message. I went here and I went there, but I always ended up right where I started. God has an unusual way of letting us know what we should do, when we should do it, and why we should do it. And tonight, I'm going to bring you a message entitled God's Wake-Up Call. God's Wake-Up Call. But before I do that, let's pledge to the Bible. I pledge allegiance to the Bible, God's holy word. I will make it a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path. I will hide its word in my heart that I might not sin against God. I'm going to be coming out of the book of Hebrews, chapter 10, starting with verse 19. Therefore, brethren, having boldness to enter the holiest by the blood of Jesus, by a new and living way which he consecrated for us through the veil that is his flesh, and having a high priest over the house of God, let us draw near with a true heart, in full assurance of faith, having our hearts sprinkled from an evil conscience and our bodies washed with pure water. Let us hold fast the confession of our hope without wavering, for he who promised is faithful. And let us consider one another in order to stir up the love and good works, not forsaking the assemblies of ourselves together as the matter of some have, but exhorting one another, and so much the more as you see the day approaching. Let us pray. Our most gracious and heavenly Father, we thank you for this opportunity to be your vessel tonight. Ask, Father, that it won't be me speaking tonight, but it'll be you speaking through me as this vessel. Hide me behind that cross, Father, and I won't be seen, but you'll be seen tonight. You'll be heard tonight, Father, and I thank and praise you for it, Father. So, Father, you take this time right now. Mold me into what you would have me to be molded into, and let me do what you would have to be done tonight, Father. And I give you praise, I give you glory and honor. And everyone said, amen. I'm full tonight, I'll tell you. Our choir practice went great. Sung a song that really touched my heart. I couldn't keep tears from flowing. But that's what God does to us when we love him. He lets us know it. But God's got a wake-up call for us. And you can see it every day. This world is just going backwards, backwards, and backwards. And we as Christians are in the world, and we're standing and sitting and watching it go backwards and backwards. We should be on our knees praying. We should be in our Bible studying God's Word. We should be looking up to him that he will give us and give us the things that we need and the desire that we need to go through what the world's going through. The world's trying to bring us down as Christians. But it can't do it. Why? Because we have a promise. God says in Matthew 28, he said, I'll go with you always, even until the end of the age. He's not going to leave us out in this world all by ourselves when all these tornadoes, all these things are going on. Just like Texas got hit, and it hit one day, and the next day it was all flooded. And they're just about to get over that. And what happened? Here come one for Florida, and it took Florida, and it tore it up. There's devastation everywhere. There's devastation going on that Satan and his ruler, but God is trying to show people. People, these things happen because I allowed it to. He says, and it's going to happen until my time comes. And I'll tell you what, my brothers and sisters, I don't think time is very far coming because of all these devastation and there's rumors of war. Now we're looking at North Korea over there. That old guy over there, I don't think he's got it all up here. I think he's a little bit twisted around. But that's my opinion, not that of everybody. But I'll tell you one thing. He told us on the news that he would come against our government, our president. He's got missiles over there that he could fire and come and hit the United States. But the United States let him know that you fire those things and we'll take care of them. We'll blow them out of the sky. Well, if we Christians, we get together and we humble ourselves together and we come together and do what God wants us to, there's nothing in this world can keep us from the love of God. There's nothing in this world that's going to take us and put us someplace we shouldn't be. We need to be on fire. We need to have our minds up on the Lord Jesus Christ and the things going on in the world today. And she mentioned it tonight. All these players out here are supposed to be examples for the kids and everything. They're kneeling down. And when they do the song, and they should be standing. When I was in school, I was taught to do this. But do you see that anymore? Not very often, do we? Not very often do we see that. We, as Christians, have sat back too long and watched things go by. And we didn't bind together in unity and in love as Christians and pray against those things. I'm just as guilty as the other one. But I'll tell you one thing. I know where I'm going, and I know my Redeemer liveth, and his name is Jesus Christ, the Son of the Almighty God. He came into my life. He changed my life. He changed my outlook. He changed my seeing. He changed my being. He changed my vocabulary and all of that things. And I'll tell you what, when I went to the work the next day, the guy says, "You got saved last night, didn't you?" I said, "Yes, I did." I said, "How did you know?" He says, "I haven't heard you curse. I haven't heard you blast anybody out here. It is 9:30 in the morning." He said, "What are you going to do about your drinking?" I says, "I'm going to drink just as much as I ever did. I'm just going to change fountains, brother, and I can drink the blood of Jesus Christ. I can take that power that he gave me. I can take that spirit that he put in here, and I can use it for his glory." And I'll tell you what, I walked with Satan for years and years, and I loved to drink. And I'll tell you what, since I got saved, I have not wanted that stuff one time. I've been offered it several times. I said, "No." He said, "Well, one won't hurt you." I said, "You don't know that, and I don't know that. I know how I loved it, and I'm not going to be tempted with it." Now, if we would stand God's ground, do what God tells us to by the Word of God, we'll be different. There's a sweet, sweet spirit in this church. I love this church because the church is growing. Why is this church growing? Because we all come together one mind and one accord. We come together to see what God's going to do. We're going to come and see what God's Spirit is going to touch, who it's going to touch, and see if they obey that Spirit. God can come down and bring His Spirit in here, but if we don't obey it, it's nothing. But I'll tell you one thing. When God's Spirit comes in and everybody looks up and everybody gets happy with the Lord Jesus Christ, you can't do anything except to love Him and to love Him and let Him know that you love Him. Boy, this isn't nothing I've got written down. But I just want to obey the Lord tonight. We need to be about Christ's business. We need to be doing what He tells us in His Word to do. And my wife says, "Gene, you want a new Bible or do you want to have that one rebound?" I said, "I'd love to have this one rebound because I've got it marked up so much. I know where they're marked at and I don't want to have to take another new one and do it." And as soon as they open up in the morning, if I get them over there to the bookstore, I'm taking it over there and they're going to send it off to have it rebound for me. Praise God, there's things that you can do and you can have things redone for God. And when you use it for God, it'll come out the way that He wants you to, as long as we are obedient to Him, as long as we allow Him to lead, guide, and direct us. And I'll tell you, I've been so nervous today. My knees, I'm standing up here in choir tonight, and my leg got to hurting. And I said, "Lord, you got to take care of this because I am scheduled to do your work tonight." And guess what? It's not hurting anymore. Oh, Satan got beat today. He got defeated today. And what's he doing? He's coming around, just looking around. He touched old brother on the shoulder, and he said, "Hey, what do you think's wrong with him up there? You think he's doing the right thing up there, or do you think he's just blowing wind?" See, that's the way Satan gets in. But all you have to do is turn around and say, Flee from me, Satan. There's no place here for you. God is my salvation. I've got power over you, so you move on. And if we learn to do that, you'd see Christians smiling a lot better, feeling a lot better. You'd see them in church when them church doors opened. You'd see them on these altars down here when altar call comes. Even when the altar call comes or not, this altar is always open. And Brad will tell you that. This altar is always, but my mouth is dry. But God wants us to be doing what he would have us to do, and we know that we should be doing this. And I thank him tonight. I praise him tonight. I'm going to go over here and see if I can find out where I'm supposed to be. Thank you, sis. I love my wife. She has stuck through with me through thick and thin. We just celebrated our 55th wedding anniversary. And I thank God for it. I praise God. I tell her every day, honey, I love you. I love you. She is what God gave me to be my right-hand person. She'll tell me, say, Gene, why did you say this? Or why did you do this way? Now, you know you were supposed to do this. She keeps me straight. She tries to keep me straight. I want to rephrase that. She keeps me straight. She tries to keep me straight. It doesn't always happen. It's a full-time job. Colossians 1, 5 and 7. For though I am absent in the flesh, yet I am with you in the spirit, rejoicing to see your good order and the steadfasting of your faith in Christ. Did you get that? For I am absent in the flesh. We can't see him as I see you. But you know what? I can sure feel him right here. I can feel him right here. Sometimes I get so full I don't know what to do with myself. And then there's other times I'll sit there and say, what's going on up there? You know why? Because I didn't read or I didn't do what God had told me to do the way he told me to do it. Then we get into trouble. And then we get, as old Tom Long, as he says, he was singing, he said, we get the old mully grubs. Get down feeling sorry for herself. I want to blame everybody else for my way of living. I want to blame everybody else for what goes on. Or you want to blame everybody else for what's going on. When we should look up and say, Lord, set me back on that straight and narrow. Show me where I need to go. Show me what I need to do. And show me how to do it. And then surrender to him. Surrender to him. The sixth verse in Colossians 1 says, as you therefore have received Christ Jesus the Lord, so walk in him. The seventh one says, rooted and built up in him and taught, abounding in it with thanksgiving. Thank the Lord for what he's done for you. Lift him up. Man, he sure lifts me up. So why shouldn't I lift him up? I need to lift him up in the spirit so that he'll know that I still love him, so that he'll know that I'm still on the track that he'd put me on. But I'll tell you what, as long as we're in the flesh, we're going to make mistakes. If I stood here tonight and tell you that I'm perfect, I'd be lying to you. Because there's not a person on earth that is perfect. The perfect one that was on earth sits beside his Father in heaven as an accessory for me and you. He takes us to the Father when we go to him. But just think, if we prayed and we prayed and we prayed, and Jesus sat up there and he says, well, this one's talking, but I ain't going to tell you what he said. Come on now, son, tell me. No, Dad, I ain't going to tell you today. I'll wait and tell you some other time. That would be awful, wouldn't it? But you know what? He is faithful and just. He hears every word we say. He hears words that we think and don't even speak. Everything we do, he sees. The things we don't do that we're supposed to do, he sees. You can't get anything by him.
But he can get everything through us if we'll just obey it to him, and that we'll do what he'd have for us to do. I don't know why this is going this way. Man, this ain't how I had it. But this whole world is a mess. And as it said in Hebrews 10, let me turn back over there. That's what I get for moving my bookmarker. Here we go. What is the church supposed to be doing? You should be praying for one another. Should be lifting everyone up. I lift my pastor up every morning and every night in prayer. And you'd probably be surprised how many of you comes to my name, and I do the same thing for you. And I pray that you're doing it for me. But you know how to get this church in the love and the fellowship that God tells us to, not forsaking the assemblies of ourselves together. We see the manner of some exhorting and another so as much as the more as you see the day approaching. Now let me back up a couple up here. The 24th verse is, and let us consider one another in order to stir up. Stir up what? God's love in us and good works. You want this church to grow? It's growing now. But I'll tell you what, if we'd quit this here busybody and yakety yak, 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 yak about everything that's going on instead of taking it to the Father and let him take care of it. Well, did you see Heather today? Oh man, she thought she was just something up there. Bing, 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 bing. When you say, I thank God for Heather and I praise God that he sent her to us and she does the job that she does. And I'll tell you what, when you do that, this church is going to grow. Or you go over to old Mrs. Loose Lips and say, did she always see me up here today, boy? Didn't he think he was something? And then Mrs. Loose Lips, she goes over there to old Drop Mouth and says, yeah, did you see James before? No, blah, 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 blah. Get that stuff out of the way. Get it out of there. Don't be talking about others in the church. Don't be bringing them down. Lift them up to the Lord Jesus Christ. Yes, I make a mistake. I've heard Brad say some things up here, and I say, where'd you get that from? You know, but I pray for him. He's human, and he's going to miss a word or two now and then, as we all do. But if we would get together and we just lift each other up, pray for each other, exhort one another, this house would be full tonight. All we have to do is quit running people down. Quit talking about this one. Quit talking about that one. Say, Lord, I got to bring this one to you. I can't talk about them. I can't go to somebody else about them because you're mine and I'm yours and they're yours and that makes us all one. So I got to pray for them. I got to lift them up to you. And guess what? The person that you're praying for will feel God's presence the same as you are. And they'll know. God will show them. Somebody really loves you. They're praying for you. Somebody really loves you because they quit that talking and going on in the church that breaks the church down. The body, you can take one person in a service and the wrong spirit can put the clamps on it. But when we come in on one mind and one accord, that thing turns up and here, come on, Lord, bless me. Give me what you've got for me to have this morning. I am willing to take it and I'm able to take it. So you pour it out on me, Father. This church would be running over. God did not promise us that we were going to be defeated. He didn't tell me I was going to be defeated. Get your mind off of the things of the world. Get your mind on Jesus. Get your mind on Jesus. My wife will tell me, she said, I don't have to worry where you're at. She said, I just got to listen. So you'll either be singing or whistling. See, she keeps track of me when I don't even know it. But I love you, honey. I love you. Now, don't you start on me when we get out of here either. Amen. But I'll tell you one thing. I wouldn't trade her for anything. And we've both said, when we die, we're going to die together. Because I don't want to be left without her and she don't want to be left without me. Why? Because that's a love that God has given us. He took two and he made one. And then when that love come in there and we're one, brother, I'll tell you what, it's just like walking away from the Lord Jesus Christ. You feel that loneliness out there. And I don't want to feel that loneliness when she's gone. And if I do live after, longer than she does, God will comfort me. Yes, he will. He'll give me that. Still give me that love. But it won't be the same as it was before because I've got a space in my life that's not there anymore. But he'll fill it with that everlasting love that he's got, that longing love that comes in there. And I'll tell you what, when that comes in there, I'll forget about her for a little while because I'm in the presence of God, but then it'll come back. And I'll tell you what, it's just as good one time as it is the next. We don't need to give up. We need to be trodden on. We need to be doing what God would have us to do. We need to be believing and believing and believing that God can and God will. I've heard too many people, oh, devil was on my back all day, all this whole week, every day. Well, get him off. What's the devil got to be on your back anyway if you're a child of God? That just burns me up when I hear that. And then, well, I've been in church for 20 some years and the devil has really beat me this week. The devil can come at you. But he can't beat you. Get behind me, man. Get behind me. God give me a power to tell you to get behind me, and he has a power over you. That's why you're fighting me so bad, because you want me back. As the song says, if I can think of it for a minute here, he lost a soul, the devil lost a soul that he thought he had, and I can't think of it. Can't think of it. He had a soul. I don't know. Anyway, thank you, Lord. But my message is tonight, all the things going on in the world, all those things that are so devastating, people went back to see their homes and all it was a foundation. People got killed. There was 57 some, I think, in the last count I heard, in Mexico over the earthquake. Puerto Rico wiped almost off. Hardly nothing left there. Here comes another one. And what's it do? The wind of it got Puerto Rico, but it got the Dominican Republic. It could come through Indiana and devastate Indiana. But we still have a higher power. That higher power is Jesus Christ, the Son of the ever-loving God. And I'm glad tonight that I know him. I'm glad tonight that when I walk with him, I know it. And I'll tell you what, when I get on my knees and when I get to praying, when I get to studying God's word, I'll sit there and tears will just flow. And I'll tell you what, my wife will be in another room in there and she'll say something to me and I'll say, what'd you say? And then we'll get right back. But we need to be doing what God tells us to do. We need to be lifting him up. If we come together in one mind and one accord, we'll see things change. And I want to tell you something right now. God's done, and I'm done. I'm not going to take you any farther, because it would be Gene doing it. God's done. Brad.
Brother, we need more of that, buddy.
Love you, buddy.
Love you, too. Amen. You've been a great...